All right, so we're now live. Welcome to Codementor Office Hours. Today we're very excited and pleased to have Thomas from Pebble joining us today.
Hi. Very excited to be here too.
Thomas is here to talk about introduction to wearable development and how easy it is to do this and develop on a Pebble. So Thomas, let's get started.
Yeah. Thanks everyone for coming. So I do this presentation quite often, but this is an amazing opportunity because we're all online. So you're on your computer, you can follow along much better than when people have their laptops on their knees. So I hope if you have a Pebble, you'll be following that presentation on your own Pebble and trying the demos. I have a short presentation that we're going to go through to kind of see how you make apps for Pebble and what are kind of the key concepts when you're building apps for a wearable like Pebble. But I really want to keep this interactive, so at any point, if you have any question, you know, just stop me and let's discuss any subject. I think this entire show will be a lot better with your questions, so I'm really looking forward to doing this. Before I start, can you guys raise your hands if you have a Pebble with you? So Gary has a Pebble, great. Anyone else? I cannot see everyone's face, but if you have a Pebble, start using it, and we're gonna, for those of you who don't have a Pebble, we're gonna start by a little tour of what Pebble is like. So let me share my screen, and hopefully you'll be able to see my slides, and if there's any problem with the transmission, you know, just please yell out too. So my name is Thomas Sarlandie, Sarfata on Twitter, and as you can probably hear by now in my accent, I'm a little French, and I have a background in mobile development, and now work for Pebble as a developer evangelist, and I've been doing this for over a year now, so I got quite some experience building apps for wearable device, and it's a very exciting ride because it's moving really, really quickly. And so seeing more and more use cases and ID pops up every week is really amazing. So before we start talking about how you build stuff for Pebble, I assume a lot of you, or some of you at least, have not seen a Pebble yet, so I'd like to show you what Pebble looks like. So I have my little camera here, and it's looking at my Pebble right now. And when you start Pebble the first time, you will see what we call watch faces. So watch faces allow you to see what time it is. So right now it's 1:36 in California. And using the up and down button on the sides of Pebble, I can scroll through different watch faces. Those are the pre-installed watch faces, and we'll see how to make our own. And if I press the select button, I can go into the Pebble menu, where I have some apps that are pre-installed, such as music, which controls the music on my phone. Notifications, which will show me what messages I've been getting in the last few hours. Alarms, if you want to be woken up in the morning by your Pebble. Watch faces allows you to choose what watch faces you want in the first menu. And then some settings, such as what activity tracker you want to use to count your steps, what apps you want to launch when you hold the button for a while, and that type of thing. So, This is what Pebble looks like from the outside, but a lot of people also wonder what's inside Pebble. So I've talked about the four hardware buttons, the back, up, select, and down. The screen is 144 by 168 pixels, and it's a black and white screen. You'll see that you can actually get pretty good gray on Pebble screen by using a technique called dithering, and we might talk about that if you guys are interested. We also have an accelerometer, which allows you to detect gravity or movement, and so we'll tell you in what direction Pebble is facing. We also have a compass, a vibration engine, so you can send some feedback to the user, and it's great because it's very discreet, and a backlight that turns on when you use the Pebble, so users can actually see what's going on the screen. Unlike some other wearable, Pebble screen is always on, so that's a very important difference, and it's very readable even in bright sunlight. So inside Pebble, what do we have? There's a processor. It's running at about 80 megahertz. The speed can go up and down. It's an ARM Cortex M3. So it's not a full computer. It's a little bit sitting between what you would find in an Arduino or that type of device and what you have inside an iPhone. In terms of power, it's comparable to the original Mac. The Mac Classic, and so the original Macintosh, and so it's very capable in terms of animation on the screen, displaying images, and that sort of stuff. It has a 4 megabytes flash on which we store the apps that developers build, and as you can see on this picture, the battery actually takes up most of the space inside your Pebble. That's a very important aspect. Again, if you have any question, please just stop me at any point. The rest of the board has the magnetometer, which is used for the compass, the ambient light sensor, which is used to detect when we need to turn the backlight on, and the accelerometer that I described earlier. So the Pebble I just showed you with my camera is called Pebble. We internally call it Pebble Classic 2. It's the first Pebble, the one that was sold on Kickstarter about 2 years ago now. And we also have a newer model called Pebble Steel that came out in was announced in January last year and shipped in March 2014. And Pebble Steel has a different casing. It's a little more professional. Some people like the style better. But the electronic is very similar. And so as a developer, there will be no difference between an app written for Pebble and an app written for Pebble Steel. So nothing to worry about here. So what can you do on Pebble? And that's a question I get a lot, and I hope we'll get to discuss your specific ideas of wearable projects. There is many things you can do with wearables, and Pebble allows you to do all of them. So we'll describe those, and then we'll do an example of some of those use cases, and I hope that will give you some new ideas. The first thing you can do on Pebble is you can write applications that run directly on the Pebble with the native C SDK. So applications that run on Pebble don't need to be connected to a phone. They will work all the time, even if the user is going for a swim or for a run. I forgot to say that Pebble is waterproof. So the C SDK is great if you want to build games or that type of highly interactive applications. One way to extend your C apps is to use JavaScript. And when you add JavaScript to your C apps, you will write code that runs on the phone. And so your app is going to talk to the phone. And on the phone, your JavaScript code will do things like use the GPS of the phone to tell your app where the user is, or show a configuration window. For example, if you have an app where you need the user to log in, type a username and a password, instead of having the user type this on the screen of the watch, which would be really complicated, you can do that on the screen of the phone, and that will be completely embedded inside the Pebble experience, and I'll show you how that works. Actually, let me show you that right now. So I'm going to switch back to the little camera, and what you can see here is the reflection on the screen of my phone. So here I have my Android phone. Pebble is compatible with iOS and Android. And this is what the Pebble app looks like. So when you start it, you have a view of your Pebble and the apps that are installed on your Pebble. And as you can see right now, I only have one app on this one. And so here I can scroll among different apps that I've loaded from the store. And if you wonder what the store looks like, you just need to click on Get Apps. And this is the Pebble App Store, where you have different categories, different apps. So you can scroll and choose apps that you'd like to install. And so for my little demo, let's just take one I have already downloaded on my phone. And so for example, let's load... we're going to load a watch face. Let's load this one, Love Weather. Click on the load button. And so this app is written in C. It's going to run completely on my Pebble. And if I look at my Pebble right now, you can see that I have this new watch face that just got loaded. And on the screen here, I have a configuration window, so I can choose to use GPS for location or not use GPS. If I don't use the GPS, I need to manually enter the name of the city that I'm in, so it will fetch it. I can say I want Fahrenheit or Celsius. I have a preference for Celsius. And when I click Submit, it will save those settings and send them to the watch. Now, if I look at the watch again, you can see that the temperature switched to Celsius. So that's what an app looks like with a configuration window. And as you can see, this app uses JavaScript to connect to the internet and fetch temperature and weather information. So that's what I just described, writing an app that talks to the internet. Another type of apps that you can write is an app that is connected to a mobile application running on iOS or Android. So for example, if you have an iOS app such as RunKeeper, and you would like your user to be able to control your app from the wrist using Pebble as a remote control for your app. That is a very, very common use case and something that users love. So to do that, you would use a slightly different SDK that we call PebbleKit, and that allows you to exchange information with a mobile app. So that's PebbleKit, and of course we have a version for iOS and for Android. And you can do things like RunKeeper, or you can do this more complicated example that is in the bottom right, where we have a sailing app on your tablet. And that sailing app communicates with Pebble to give you a display that's available on your wrist of what is your current cape, the distance to your next waypoint, how much time until your next waypoint. And so if you're sailing and it's really wet outside, you can leave your iPad inside the boat where it's safe and dry and just take your Pebble with you outside. I really like that app. And there are tons of examples of Pebble apps that remote control a mobile app. Philips, you many examples. And if you have questions about that, I'd love to discuss that too. And finally, there's another way if you don't like C, if you're not a C developer and you just want to write apps that talk to the internet, you're a web developer, you know JavaScript, and you'd like to use JavaScript. We have a framework called Pebble.js, which allows you to write Pebble apps completely in JavaScript. And today, for my demonstration, I'll start with this one, because if you're just starting writing Pebble apps, Pebble.js really is the easiest way to get started. So before I start my demo and I start showing you how to make an app, I'd like to ask you guys if you have any question at this point. Okay. Can you hear me well? Gary, can you confirm the screen is okay? Yeah, cool. Thank you so much. Okay. So to do Pebble development, there is one tool that you should know about, one tool that you should use, and it's called Cloud Pebble. And let me turn my camera on for a minute. So to build Pebble apps, you need a Pebble software development kit, an SDK. And there are two different SDKs you can use. One is the SDK that you download on your computer, just like you would download the Android SDK or the iOS SDK. And the other one is an SDK that you can use completely online. It's called Cloud Pebble. It's available at cloudpebble.net. And with Cloud Pebble, you can build Pebble apps without installing anything on your computer. Everything happens on your browser. It works on Linux. It works on Windows. It works on Mac. It even works on your iPad. And with Cloud Pebble, really, you can build apps in just a few minutes. And this is what I'll be showing you today. It's an extremely powerful solution. We're going to do some basic examples, but you can build really complicated apps with Cloud Pebble. So if you've never done any Pebble development, I really, really recommend that you start with Cloud Pebble. You'll find that the experience is really easy. So let's see what Cloud Pebble looks like. Let me share my screen again. So this is cloudpebble.net. First time you come, you will have to log in. The username and password that you use to connect to CloudPebble are the same that you use with your Pebble account when you install the Pebble mobile application for the first time. And here I have a list of all my projects that I've worked on. And today I created a very simple Codementor project. And to do this, you click Create New Project, Codementor, and you choose what type of project you want to build. And so you can use the Pebble C SDK, or you could use the Pebble.js framework that I just mentioned. It's still in beta, but it's a beta that's pretty solid. You can actually use it for your apps today. Simply.js is an earlier version of Pebble.js. It's still supported, but we recommend that you use Pebble.js now. It's much more powerful. If you create a C project, you can choose from a selection of examples, and I'll get to those very soon. Actually, let's get to those right now. Let's build a Hello World example, and I'm going to call it Hello Codementor. I choose Pebble C SDK, and I'm going to select the Hello World example. I click Create. And this starts a new Pebble project, and this project here, as you can see in the left, has one source file called helloworld.c. And if I click on this file, I have a Pebble application, a full Pebble application. And here I'm just going to change the text that's displayed on the screen. I'm going to say, hi, Codementor. I'm going to save this. And now that I have my my simple project here, if I just click the green arrow here, I will load the project on my Pebble. So the way this works is that Cloud Pebble here, which is running in your browser, will connect to a development server that we have. It's an infrastructure that we deployed that allows you to link your Cloud Pebble instance, your Cloud Pebble account, to your phone and to your Pebble. And so to get this to work, there's one step that you need to take on your watch first, on your phone, sorry. And so this step here is going to need to, I'm going to unlock my phone. And here I'm going to go into the developer. I'm going to go into settings first. And in settings, you need to make sure that the developer connection service is enabled. So you check this little box. And then here, if it's enabled, you have developer here. If you click on it, you can see what is your IP address, and you can see that the server is enabled for me. And so now, I'm going to keep the window here. If I go back into Cloud Pebble, when I press the deploy button, so this grid arrow, it's going to save my project, it's going to compile my project, and then it's going to connect to my phone. And so you can see it's connected, and then it deploys it to my Pebble. So you can see my Pebble is saying, hi, Codementor. So this is really the first step to Pebble development, is figuring out how you deploy an app on your Pebble. And as you can see, it's extremely simple. You don't need to install anything on your computer. Everything happens from your web browser. So that's how to do a first app. And here we have an example of an app written in C that you can modify, play with, and add more features for your purpose. What I'd like to show you today is how to build a very simple app that connects to the internet, grabs weather information, and displays weather information. And to show that, I'm going to go back to the JavaScript SDK, because we'll be able to do this in fewer lines of code than if we are using C. So I'm going to click Projects here, and I'm going to select this Codementor project. And because it's a JavaScript project, instead of having a .c file, I have a .js file here. And when I open it, I see that I'm loading two libraries. One is the UI libraries. The other one is the AJAX library that we're going to need to make HTTP requests. And then I create what we call a new card. So a card is just a screen on the Pebble. And I set a title, I set a body, and then I have a function called main.show, and so I'm showing this main card that I just created. So let me press deploy here, and it will connect again via my phone, push the app to the Pebble, and you're going to see the app show up on my Pebble directly. Takes a few seconds. There's a little vibration, and you can see the app running here on my Pebble. So if I look at the code here, I have title, Codementor, that's what you're seeing here, and then body starting, and that's what you're seeing here. Okay, so let me go back to my slides for a second just to explain how we're going to get the weather information. To get the weather information, you need a source of weather information, so some kind of open API on the web. It's often the first part of a project is finding what API you're going to use. I get a lot of requests from developers who ask me, can I do this, can I do this? And the answer is, if you have an API, the answer is yes. So as long as you have an API, you can do almost anything with your Pebble. So if you want to get weather information, there's a very nice service called openweathermap.org, which has a free API that you can use. It gives you a lot of information for weather. And so here, I went to that website, openweathermap.org, and I see that they have a JSON API. And so I click on that link, I read the documentation, and I find out that to call the API, the only thing I need to do is call http://api.openweathermap.org/data/2.1/find/city. And you pass latitude and longitude, which are GPS information. So here they're hard-coded for Washington, D.C. And it returns this block here of JSON. And the JSON that's returned by API is usually compressed. It's hard to read. And so I strongly recommend going to a service like jsonlint.com, where you can just copy-paste what you got and display it nicely, like it's here on the screen. So as you can see in this example, the temperature in DC when I prepared my slide, and that was just 2-3 weeks ago, fall, but 279 degrees seems like a lot for Washington, DC. And the reason for that is in the API documentation. So my point here is having the API is great. Having the documentation that goes with the API is often very, very important, because if you don't have the documentation, there are going to be values in there that you're not going to understand. So here I looked at the documentation, and I see that the temperature is given in degrees Kelvin, and so I need to subtract 273.15 to convert that to Celsius. Okay, great. And so now I'm going to go back to Cloud Pebble, call this URL here at the top of the screen, and we're going to see how we read and parse the JSON response and how we display it to the screen of Pebble. I hope you can all see what I'm typing well. If it's not clear and you need me to increase the font size, please tell me. Actually, I'm going to do it before you tell me, because I assume that will help. So here we're starting our app. So we showed that card. It's going to show starting. So instead of starting, we're going to say loading. And so when the app starts, it's going to show the screen. And then what we want to do is call the service. And so the service here, the URL was http://api.openweathermap.org/data/2.1/find/city. And then we said we need to pass two parameters. The first one is the latitude of the city, and so I happen to be in Palo Alto today, 37 degrees of latitude north, and the longitude is 122 degrees of longitude west, so I need to add a minus sign here, and dot 1381. And so if you go to Google Maps, you can see where is the Pebble office very precisely. Then I'm going to add a parameter called cont, C-N-T, and I'm going to say I only want to get one city. And to make sure I got that right, what I'm going to do now is call this URL. So here I'm copy-pasting this, and I'm going to open a terminal window on my Mac. And you can use the curl tool to do that. It's perfect. So again, going to increase this here. You can see that I got the same reply that I was showing on the slides. And if I copy paste this into jsonlint.com, you can see that it formats nicely. And so the information that we want to grab here is there's a list of results. And in this list of results, we're going to take the first result, and we're going to look for the key called main.temp. So let me go back to my Cloud Pebble window here. So we have our URL, and to make an URL request in JavaScript, we use this little Ajax library. It's very similar to what you would find in jQuery, and this takes a first parameter, which is an object with a key being the URL that we want to call that we just define up here, and the second one is the type. So I'm going to say that the type of this service is a JSON web service, so it will automatically parse the output. Then I'm going to give this function a second parameter, and the second parameter here is going to be a callback that will be called when the HTTP request is complete, and it will get a parameter, and the parameter will be the data that was returned. And so to get the temperature, what I need to do is get the data information, and from that data, said I need to look into lists, get the first element, and then look at the main temperature. We want to convert that into Celsius first, so subtract 273.15, and then we're going to convert that into Fahrenheit, and so going to multiply by 1.8 and add 32. So I've done this before, and I know that this gives non-exact results, and so I'm going to use another JavaScript function to round that to only one decimal. And then I'm going to reuse the main card that we declared up there, and I'm going to say main.body. So that's going to change the body of the card, and I'm going to say I want to show the temperature, and temperature is in the variable called temp. And I'm going to add a little F so you know it's Fahrenheit. Always useful. I can pass a second parameter, and I strongly recommend that you do that just in case there is an error. And so here I can use console.log. And we'll see where those logs go and log an error like this. And actually, when I get the data here, what I'm going to do is also send on the console the data that was received, and so we're going to convert that into a string and do that when we're done here. Okay, so what's going to happen here is we start our app, we create that first window here, we say Codementor loading, then we show that first window, then we declare our URL, and then we make our HTTP request to this URL with the type JSON, and when the HTTP request completes, we're going to display the temperature on the screen, and if there's an error, we're going to display an error. You can see that I have little help pointers here in Cloud Pebble telling me that I'm missing a semicolon. This works in C as well, and it's very useful. So let's save this and relaunch this on my Pebble. So click the deploy button, show the screen of Pebble. You need to make sure that the Pebble app is open on your phone, otherwise it won't be able to connect and deploy. So I just re-unlocked my phone, and here the app is installing, and it's showing the temperature in Palo Alto, 65.3 degrees Fahrenheit. And now if I click on view logs here, remember we asked to log the information that we got from the web service, and so this is what you get here. You see message, and you can see everything that was returned from the web service. So it correctly converted the longitude and the latitude to Palo Alto. It knows how far I am from the center of the town, from the weather station, and I also get the pressure, the min temp, the max temp, et cetera, et cetera. So this is really how you build a Pebble app that connects to the internet. You can use this to do much more complicated things as long as you have access to web service. So you could use this to show Google Analytics information on your watch. You can use this to control your lights if you have a Philips Hue at home. If you're into Nest, you can use this to talk to Nest as well. I mean, there's really few limits to what you can do as soon as you can make a HTTP request and talk to the internet. I would like to go back to my slides for just a sec and then take some questions. So here we build this. And sorry, let me show you screen again. So this is what we've built. You may wonder, like, how do I do this? And I explain all of this. Let me skip this. You may wonder, how do I do this and automatically get the current position of the user? And so that's very easy. You can use a standard HTML5 function, such as navigator.geolocation.getCurrentPosition. That's the HTML5 API for GPS. And that will return a variable that will actually call a callback and passing a parameter with the current coordinates of the phone. So you can use this to dynamically get weather information instead of hard coding it in the app, like I did in my little example. But the only thing you need to add here is this function call to the HTML5 API. So now that we've seen how to get started with Pebble, just wanted to give you some example of things Pebble developers have done. One is Tiny Bird. It's available in the store. It's an adaptation of the very famous Flappy Bird. It works really well. It's really addictive on Pebble too. This is a game written in C, but if you're interested in games and you want to see what's possible, it's a great example. Some people do ray tracing on Pebble. So in this middle example, you have a ball that's on a checkered board, and that's being rendered completely on Pebble in 3D. And if you're more into useful apps, another great example is Peb GPS here on the right, which will take a destination and will show you on your Pebble which turns to take at every corner. So those are, you know, just a very small selections of apps that exist in the Pebble App Store. I would really say the first step is to get inspiration is to go to the App Store in the Pebble app, or if you don't have a Pebble yet, you can go to pblweb.com and you can see what are all the apps available and play with them. And finally, the key resource for Pebble development is our website, so developer.getpebble.com. You'll find guides on how to design your Pebble apps, recommendations, standard practices for UI on Pebble, guides for development in C, development in JavaScript, development of your mobile apps on iOS or Android. Of course, you'll find full API reference for all of our APIs and examples. And if you have questions, the Pebble forums are extremely active, very strong community there. Pebble development has been the SDK, the first version is almost 2 years old now, so there's a lot of Pebble developers, and the forums are a great place to ask questions and also just chat with us or with other Pebble developers. On our GitHub account, we have a lot of examples, and Stack Overflow is getting bigger and bigger on the Pebble subject. So if you have a Pebble question, post it to Stack Overflow and tag it with the Pebble-SDK a keyword, and you should get an answer really, really quickly. That's it for my little intro, and now I'd like to turn it to you and ask you first if you have any question, and then maybe discuss your specific project IDs and discuss what are the best ways to build your projects.
Here's a question in the chat section. So is the connection between Pebble and mobile phone Is it Bluetooth?
Yeah. Yeah, so I'm sorry for not seeing those questions earlier. I see different questions, so I'll try to answer all of them. As I should have said when I showed you what the inside of Pebble looks like, we have a Bluetooth module on the back of the PCB of Pebble. And this Bluetooth module is what we call a dual mode Bluetooth radio, meaning that it can do Bluetooth 2.1, which is the classic Bluetooth protocol that we've known and used for a few years now, that's used when your phone connects to your car or when you're using headset, a wireless headset for your phone. That's Bluetooth 2.1. And so that's the main connection between your Pebble and your phone. There is another type of Bluetooth that Pebble also supports that's called Bluetooth Low Energy, also known as BLE, Bluetooth Smart, Bluetooth 4. There's many names for it. And BLE is also supported by Pebble, and it's used right now mostly to send notifications to your Pebble. We have an experimental API for developers, so if you have projects that would like to use BLE, it's possible, but you need to contact us to get the SDK. Does that answer your question, Dharmendra? Okay, cool. Thank you. When is or is there a color screen envisioned? That's another great question. Thank you. The reason why Pebble is not in color is because we want to make sure that Pebble works well where people are going to be using Pebble. And people use Pebble all day long in the street, in bright sunlight. And right now, we have not found a good screen that gives good contrast and good readability in bright sunlight. And so it's a technology limitation, but right now we think it's more important to have a good visibility and to keep a screen that's extremely readable in sunlight rather than just doing colors for the sake of colors. Doing black and white has actually not been a limitation for most of the apps people are building today. And as soon as we'll find a screen that's good enough to get good readability, but also to maintain good battery life, because Pebble has a 1 week battery life right now, that's something that we really care about maintaining, then we will envision building a Pebble with a color screen. So I'm gonna start back from the top. Jacqueline, you asked about the URL. I assume the URL you wanted to get is the Cloud Pebble URL. So I'm going to share that with you guys. This is the URL for Cloud Pebble. And the other key resource is developer.getpebble.com. It's our developer website. That's where you should go to download examples, find the SDK, and in general, all of our documentations. And then Gary posted the URL for the weather, so okay, sorry. Regarding smartphones in general, can you explain the purpose of the SIM card? Is it just to enable calling from the smartwatch? Yeah, so we don't have a SIM card in Pebble because Pebble does not connect to the 3G network. I'm not a cell phone expert, but the general purpose of the SIM card is to authenticate a specific user on the GSM or 3G wireless network. Because Pebble does not connect to that network, we don't need a SIM card, until there's no SIM card in Pebble. Is data visualization down the road with Pebble? So yes, there are a lot of apps that do data visualization already on Pebble. There are many definitions to what data visualization is or could be. If you look at apps on the store, you'll find apps that connect to different web services like Google Analytics or I don't have their names on the top of my head right now, but there are other services that aggregate data for you from different sources, and they have Pebble apps to push that data on your Pebble. I think if you search for data visualization on the App Store, you would probably find a few apps. Great question from Gary on how to deal with floats and math efficiently. So I didn't mention this earlier, but the CPU that is used on Pebble doesn't have a floating point unit, so it cannot use hardware accelerated operation on floating point number. So there are two ways to deal with that. They both evolve around using fixed point instead of using floating point. Fixed point math is when you you know how many digits you want after the comma. And so you can either just multiply all your numbers by 1,000 if you know that you only care about three digits after the comma, after the digital separator, sorry. In the US, it's going to be a dot, but yeah, you got what I meant. And so you can multiply all your numbers by 1,000. Or if you look at how we handle angles on Pebble, there's all the function like the compass that will give you a heading. Instead of taking a value between 0 to 360, it takes a value between 0 and 10,000 in hexadecimal, and then you divide 10,000 by 360 to get the value of 1 degree. So that's the general idea of doing very simple fixed point. If you actually have requirements for more precise math, if you want to do things like fast Fourier transform or do some kind of signal processing, which is completely possible on Pebble, and remember that we have step trackers on Pebble that count your steps, and so those do FFTs and that type of things in real time on Pebble, and you still get very good battery life. So you can use a fixed point library that will replace the default floating point implementation of the compiler. And if you want more details on this, we have a presentation from the Pebble Developer Retreat 2014 called Size, and it covers different ways of optimizing your apps for size. It is available on the developer website in video and in slides. And in there, we have an example of how to use the fixed point. And that example is also available on our GitHub account. If you have trouble finding that, just send me an email and I will very gladly send you links. Jacqueline asked, is there a mechanism for the watch to dial 911 on the phone even without SIM, even without a SIM card? So that's a great question. Because of the way iOS and Android are designed, Pebble cannot dial number directly on the phone because that could create incur cost for the user. So iOS doesn't let us dial a phone number. If you're on Android, you could build an app that would dial 911 and that would work without a SIM card. But that would be an Android-only app, and that would not work on iOS. I hope that answers your question. And that will work without SIM card. Joao asks, are there any market penetration strategies for other countries? I see Pebble is shipped overseas, but I'm in South America, and wearables are still starting around here. Yes, so... we are expanding to more and more countries, and there are different ways we are doing this. One of them is selling through our website, getpebble.com, to the entire world. So you can go to getpebble.com, and you actually get free shipping everywhere in the world. Now, if you're in some countries like Argentina, you do have pretty hefty import duties. And so we're working with local distributors to set up channel there. We've worked with Europe, Canada, some countries in Asia, and we're expanding to more countries. So yes, we will be coming to South America very soon. And something else that we're doing and that developers are going to be very involved with is starting to translate Pebble in different languages. And so you'll see very soon that you'll be able to get Pebble in your own language. And we will also give you developers the ability to build apps for a specific language. And I'd like to add that if you have some specific ID, for example, you need 20 Pebble for a specific audience, you know, or something like that, you know, you can always contact us, devsupport@getpebble.com, and we can certainly help you get them and get them at a better price. Absolutely feel free to reach me or my team, and we'll help you get that. Gary asks, how to log for debugging purposes when in an event-driven loop? My app seems to lock up possibly because there's too many. Yes, that's something I should have shown earlier. So let me show my screen again and show you how to get logs. It's extremely easy. I showed the logs view, so let me reopen that. So when you deploy an app, you have that view logs button, and another way to get it is to go into compilation and here click view app logs. And so here, on my Pebble, you see I'm starting an app, switching to another app, and you can see some debugging information in the logs here. So that's how you would get information from the Pebble to you as a developer, so you can easily debug what's going on in the Pebble. Now, your question is, you have an event loop and you want to debug efficiently, and that's a more complicated problem. All your log messages are going to be sent via Bluetooth, and so if you're also using Bluetooth to do another type of communication, exchanging messages with JavaScript code or talking to an iOS or an Android app or anything like that, there is an impact of the logs on your app, because the logs are going to slow down your app, especially if you're trying to log 20 times per second. So my advice to you is, instead of sending a message every time you go through the loop, make your log messages a little bit smarter. For example, if you're trying to debug, you know, when something explodes, just if the value is out of the normal bounds, then show a log message. If you're trying to debug timing problem, you can have a timer and you can say, if it's been more than 20 milliseconds since the last call, then I'm going to show a specific message and say, hey, here I have a problem. But don't push logs continuously, because especially if you try to go more than 15, 20 messages per second, you're just going to go too fast. The Bluetooth link is not going to be fast enough, and so you're going to start dropping log messages, and that's not going to help you. I hope that answers your question. Those were great questions, guys. Do you have a few more? Okay, I'll take a sip of water while you think about it. Do you have any specific project ideas that you're not sure what would be the best way to build them? We've talked about different APIs. Maybe some of you are wondering what APIs you should use for your project. That's another very classic question. You would love to push a button on a watch and record a message. What kind of message? Reminder, yeah. Something that works very well that I've seen done at a few hackathons is having an iOS or an Android app talk to Pebble. And when you press a button on the Pebble, you send a message to your iOS app, and the iOS app uses the microphone on the phone to record. And that's something that actually works very well, because most of the time the phone is not far away at all from the Pebble. And even if we don't have a microphone on Pebble, you can still record like this. I've seen people do Shazam-type use case where you press a button and starts recording for 30 seconds, and then does music recognitions and send you the reply to your watch. Yeah, so Jacqueline replied, yeah, in my purse it will be muffled. Yeah, that is true. There's no mic on Pebble, so right now, if we're talking voice recording, that's the best you can do. If you can have predefined messages, which works well, for example, to reply to text messages or things like that. You can have predefined replies, and then you can just pick from one of those predefined replies. I'm not sure if that would cut it for your use case. Rebecca asks, in terms of hardware, is there any plan to include possibility of measuring body metrics, pulse, as the S5 can do? You're developing app for endurance and athletes. Not in Pebble, but if you want to explore that type of apps, I recommend that you get in touch with me, and I'll send you the Bluetooth Low Energy enabled SDK. And that allows your app running on Pebble to connect to BLE accessories. And there are body sensors available with BLE APIs for a lot of different body metrics. So you can get heart rate, respiration volume, breathing volume. You can get a lot of information like this through BLE gizmos. And also, if your athletes are on bikes, there are great sensors available for bikes that will make the information as available via BLE. So the Pebble will just sit on the user wrist and connect to those accessories via BLE, and then you can aggregate the information, do stats, display it, let the user interact with it, say, hey, I'm starting a new run or starting a sprint, and then... once you've processed the information, you can maybe save it on the watch or save it on a mobile app on iOS or Android. Great. Am I reading all the questions here from the Codementor side? Do you have any other questions that I missed?
No, I believe that's about it. Do we have any more questions for Thomas before we conclude the session? No? All good? All set?
What's the best way to get in touch with you? Yeah, great question. I was going to end with that, so that's a perfect perfect way to end the session. So you can reach me directly, Thomas, Thomas, at getpebble.com. If you have a developer-related question in general, you can also write to dev support, one word, at getpebble.com, and someone from the team, I'm not alone, we'll get back to you very quickly with an answer. You can follow me on Twitter, at Sarfata, S-A-R-F-A-T-A, or you can find the entire Pebble Dev team and follow news on at Pebble Dev. We have a developer newsletter that you will automatically be subscribed to when you use the SDK for the first time and when you download it. And in general, forums, email, all of those I've covered. So yeah, that should be those are the best way to get in touch with me. Let me know if you have any questions after this presentation. Always happy to chat with developers and help them figure out the best way to build their apps. We also do have Pebbles available for developers, so I didn't cover that, but the normal price for Pebble today is $99, but if you send me an email, if you listen to this presentation, I will very happily send you a coupon. And so, so you can get your Pebble with a discount. So, if you need a Pebble to get started, send me an email, and we'll make sure you get a sweet price on your first Pebble. Thank you everyone for joining the session. Great question. It was awesome having everyone here. And again, let's keep the discussion going, going online by different means. And let us know what you end up building. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Thomas. Thank you so much, everyone. Take care.
Bye.
Bye.